Well, 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 ladies and gentlemen, look who Adam Shifty Shift has family ties to. Even though a majority of the time Twitter seems to be against President Donald Trump, Twitter is on fire and you can learn a lot from it with this revelation that Democratic Party mouthpiece Adam Shifty Shift turns out to have family ties to none other than George Soros himself. Tweets like Todd Griffith who say, "Here is something interesting I found out today. Adam Schiff's sister, Melissa, was married to George Soros' son until 2015. And another tweet by Patriot 24/7. Fact, Adam Schiff's sister, Melissa, is a Soros, or at least was. Also, there is a Soros tie to Schumer and the Clintons." Well, I don't know about that one. We'll look at that later. This is from Breitbart. Those family ties obviously helped Adam Schiff score big bucks from Soros Move On to boost his political career. That's moveon.org. Representative Adam Schiff, the ranking Democrat on the House Intelligence Committee, was previously financially aided by the George Soros-financed moveon.org to win his congressional seat. Schiff was also awarded the Toll Fellowship, which is sponsored by the Council of State Governments, a nonprofit that monitors federal government activities and is heavily financed by Soros' Open Society Foundation. The Open Society and Soros-funded groups have additionally supported a number of Schiff's legislative efforts. And it looks like for those efforts, Schiff has been helping to lead the Democrats' unsubstantiated charges of alleged collusion between President Donald Trump and Moscow. Wow. Last month, Schiff delivered the opening statements at a congressional hearing where he laid out the case for alleged Russian meddling in the 2016 presidential election. This reporter previously documented serious problems with Schiff's charges, which included wild conspiracy theories and heavy reliance on a questionable source. And guess what? In largely forgotten history, of course, Schiff's 2000 congressional campaign against Republican incumbent Jim Rogan was openly aided by MoveOn.org. On January 1st, 2000, the Wall Street Journal reported on the radical group's fundraising efforts for Schiff. The congressional seat was particularly important since Rogan had gained fame after he was selected to be one of 13 House managers in the 1998 impeachment case of Bill Clinton. Rogan was supportive of Clinton's impeachment and became a hero in the Republican Party. And unfortunately, sometimes good things have to come to an end. The divorce between Adam Schiff's sister and George Soros' son was a messy one. This from The Observer in July of 2015, with this property transfer, I the divorce Melissa Schiff Soros, the soon-to-be ex-wife of Robert Soros, has paid her estranged husband $10 million for the privilege of taking possession of the townhouse they once shared. The couple, who are in the midst of a messy divorce, have provided the tabloids with some delightful fodder of late, including reports that Mr. Soros, the eldest son of George Soros and president of his father's $28 billion firm, canoodled with the 29-year-old girlfriend in front of his wife on an 8-hour-plus flight from Italy. Obviously now as Miss Schiff Soros, a filmmaker and photographer apparently had a strong desire to hang on to their charming West Village townhome, broken or not. The house is notable for being where Thomas Wolfe wrote the first draft of his novel, Look, Homeward Angel. The couple bought the house in 1993, a year after their marriage, according to city records, though the price they paid was not recorded. The Soroses have two college-aged children who might presumably wish to return to their old bedrooms. The world we live in, ladies and gentlemen, is not what it seems to be, is it? The Shifty Shift Adam Shift is making a lot of shift.
Committee Chairman Bob Goodlatte and House Oversight Committee Chairman Trey Gowdy both penning a letter to the Attorney General asking for a second special counsel, citing as part of that these so-called FISA abuses. So I asked the Attorney General what he thinks of their request.
Well, I have great respect for Mr. Gowdy and Chairman Goodlatte, and we're going to consider seriously their recommendations. I have appointed a person outside of Washington many years in the Department of Justice to look at all the allegations that the House Judiciary Committee members sent to us, and we're conducting that investigation. I also am well aware that we have a responsibility to ensure the integrity of the FISA process. We're not afraid to look at that. The Inspector General, some think that our Inspector General is not very strong, but he has almost 500 employees, most of which are lawyers and prosecutors, and they are looking at the FISA process. We must make sure it's done properly, and we're going to do that, and I'll consider their request.
I know that a couple of things the chairman outlined, that they were worried that the Inspector General wouldn't have the same kind of access or subpoena powers to certain people who may not be under the reach of the DOJ as employees. What do you say to that concern?
That's a concern that I think is worthy of consideration, and we will consider that and are considering it, actually.
Okay, so the FISA applications that we've heard so much about in the news, there have been requests directly to the FISA court to be able to see some of that material. It's been referred back to the DOJ. Would you all release those applications so that people can see what was in them?
I am determined to release everything that's properly releasable. It does tend to be that the more you put these documents out, many of which are very sensitive, the more they leak. So we have to be careful about that. We also have to follow the rules of the department and legal requirements. So, but we, for example, the text messages that caused quite a stir, those were produced at our effort to make sure we produce everything possible. The Inspector General actually found those first, and then we made that public and determined we could make it public. Some objected to it. So you're raising a good point. We need to get as much public out to the public as possible and do it in a way that breeds confidence. And if there are errors within the department, we need to fix them. So we've got a new FBI director. President Trump appointed him. He's a talented person. He's got a new deputy replacing the previous deputy. We've got a new chief of staff in the FBI, a new communications director, a new chief counsel. So we've got a fresh start at the FBI, and these are people of integrity and ability. So I want the American people to know that things are being done, and we'll have the kind of department that everybody can respect. That is a determination of mine, and but we got to do it in a proper way.
And as to these decisions that you're making, a very famous tweet the president sent out last week saying, why is AG Jeff Sessions asking the Inspector General to investigate potentially massive FISA abuse? Will take forever, has no prosecutorial power, and already late with reports on Comey, etc. Isn't the IG an Obama guy, he questions. Why not use Justice Department lawyers? All caps, disgraceful. You followed up with a statement that said, as long as I'm the Attorney General, I will continue to discharge my duties with integrity and honor. You talked about the work that's been done and what you have launched and feeling it's the appropriate process. Then you went out to dinner with the Deputy Attorney General, Rod Rosenstein, and the Solicitor General. And I'm not sure how that went over at the White House. What's the status of things?
Well, he's my deputy, and Noel is a great Solicitor General and a lot of fun, so we had an opportunity to dine together. But look, the president is the president of the United States. He has a right to criticize and make suggestions to the Department of Justice. We take that with great respect. What I said in that statement also was, we are determined to make sure the American people have confidence in the FISA process. That was part of my statement, too. And I say that as long as I'm Attorney General, we're going to make sure we do those things with integrity and justice as the American people want.
The president has said just within the last couple of days, he likes some chaos. He likes some conflict. He thinks it makes him better, his decisions better, and that he likes to mix it up. And a lot of people say, well, this style is working. He is actually ticking things off of his agenda and getting things accomplished. What do you make of his management style?
I think President Trump moves the ball. He can get things done that I'm not sure any other person in America could get done. He is bold. He's not worried about what people say. I believe in the policies that he's advancing. That's why I supported him so early for president. He was saying the things that I thought Americans had a right to hear. He was promising to act on those things and get things done, and he does not like things not getting done. Mm-hmm. He keeps pushing every day. It's a remarkable strength that he has, and I think it's good for America.
California's governor is accusing U.S. Attorney General Jeff Sessions of launching a legal war against California. Well, I interviewed the Attorney General here in California, asked him about his reaction to cities like Oakland warning illegals about impending ICE raids. Here's what he said.
We've got to challenge it. I don't want to do that. California is a great state with an important part of America. We wanted a healthy and good relationship with it. But federal law determines immigration policy. State of California is not entitled to block that activity. Somebody needs to stand up and say, no, you've gone too far. You cannot do this. This is not reasonable. It's radical, really. It's an affirmation, if you want to know the truth, of the idea that we should not have immigration laws, that we should have an open borders, because whenever anyone is apprehended, it seems that we have persons who want to block their removal from the country, no matter what the circumstances. It's an extreme position that's being taken by some here, a lot of the government agencies here, and we just have to push back. I wish it weren't so, but it is.
And your message basically this morning was, we're not asking state and local authorities here to help us actively enforce ICE immigration enforcements or laws, but we're saying don't actively obstruct what we're trying to do.
That's exactly right. People have tried to spin this as somehow that we're demanding that the state and local officials go out and do the work of the federal government. We'd like their help. Most states and jurisdictions around the country help happily, but we just cannot allow them to obstruct or block the ability of federal officers to do the job they are lawfully required to do.
All right, let's talk about some of the reaction. Not surprising. Governor Brown says Jeff Sessions has come to California to further divide and polarize America. The Attorney General here, Javier Becerra, said essentially this is a B-rated movie.
I don't know what Mr. Becerra means by that, but he has repeatedly threatened businesses in California, telling them he will prosecute them under the new California law if they even admit voluntarily ICE officers.